President Trump throwing a body block at LeBron James after the NBA star said this in an interview with CNN's Don Lemon.
That he's kind of used sport to kind of divide us, and that's something that I can't relate to.
Trump tweeted that LeBron James was just interviewed by the dumbest man on television, Don Lemon. He made LeBron look smart, Molly Hemingway. So the president's counterpunching here against LeBron's criticism and Don Lemon, who attacks him on the air every night. But does it make sense for him to be brawling with an NBA star and a cable news opinion host?
No, it's a puerile tweet that a lot of people don't like to see their president going after athletes. They also don't like to see athletes going after their president. We see a little bit of unevenness in the coverage. But I felt kind of bad. You know, he really gave it to Don Lemon. And a lot of people in the media, including some of his own colleagues, only focused on what he said about LeBron James. Maybe both of them needed a defense.
Right. Capri, Lemon then took to Twitter and wrote, "Who's the real dummy? A man who puts kids in classrooms," this is LeBron's effort in Akron, Ohio, "or one who puts kids in cages?" Should a cable news host take the bait and directly denounce the president of the United States, even though he clearly detests the president of the United States?
Look, I mean, as Molly said, I mean, he's always, Don Lemon is always kind of, you know, resisting against Donald Trump every night on CNN. But if the tables were turned, I mean, Don Lemon is giving some Trump to Trump. He's sounding just like him. And, you know, people praise Donald Trump for saying, you know, he's not, if he has his back up against the wall and you challenge him, he's going to fight back. That's what Don Lemon did. Is it potentially in poor taste? Probably, but
okay.
I get it.
Interesting footnote, a dissent from Melania Trump, her office issuing a statement saying, looks like LeBron James is working to do good things. First Lady encourages that because he's trying to help at-risk
children. We welcome her to Akron.
Okay. Oh, that's right. You're from Ohio. You get to say that. All right. So New York Times publisher A.G. Sulzberger has a private meeting with President Trump. It's supposed to be off the record. The president tweets about it, says we talked about fake news. And then Sulzberger pushes back. So, Jillian, the mere fact that this meeting took place with the failing New York Times, does it not suggest that the president really does care about the opinion of his hometown newspaper?
Well, there's no doubt in anybody's mind that the president cares about the opinion of the mainstream fake news media because he talks about it constantly. But the more important thing with this meeting is that it underscores something I love to talk about whenever I'm covering the president's foreign policy, mm-hmm. which is that he really does believe fervently in the power of his own interpersonal skills. If he can just get one-on-one, face-to-face with all these people that are critical of him, he can make them see the light and get them to understand him, whether it's Kim Jong-un, whether it's Vladimir Putin, or whether it's Sulzberger.
I've seen him do it. He did it with Karl Rove during the campaign in a green room. So Sulzberger is a 37-year-old new publisher of the Times, Molly, put out a long statement saying that he told the president that his rhetoric was dangerous. "I warned that this inflammatory language is contributing to a rise in threats against journalists and will lead to violence." Now, I understand him wanting to defend the paper, but do you think that that goes a little too far?
I think there are two problems with his statement. One is that if inflammatory rhetoric causes violence against people, I think the media should be thinking about their inflammatory rhetoric against Republicans, which we have seen in recent years have led to actual shooting of congressmen, other threats on people's lives, people getting arrested routinely. If that's true, even though I think personally that people are responsible for their own actions and you can't blame the rhetoric, then the media have a lot of hard questions to answer. The other thing is, he says Donald Trump's rhetoric is dangerous and divisive. This week, the New York Times hired Sarah Jong on their editorial page. She is a virulent racist.
We'll talk about that later.
And they defended it as if it's not a problem. They need to hold themselves to the high standard they're holding others.
And in short, there are two sides to this debate. So then finally, the president comes back with a series of tweets, and one of them, Capri, is the media, when the media, driven insane by their Trump derangement syndrome, reveal internal deliberations of our government, it truly puts the lives of many, not just journalists, at risk. Very unpatriotic. What do you make of him using that word? And revealing the secrets of government, that's gone on since the founding of the Republic.
Well, I think we've come up with a new Trumpism, which is the Trump derangement syndrome. I suspect we're going to continue to maybe hear that from President Trump and his tweets going forward. I think that this back and forth between the account of what happened in this private meeting between the New York Times and President Trump is emblematic of basically the huge debate we're having as a nation. Who do we trust and who do we believe is telling the truth, the president of the United States or the mainstream media, in this case, the New York Times?
Yeah, I would just add that reporting on government behind the scenes, if it's the EPA or the HHS, both of which whose leaders were fired as a result of that reporting, it's not unpatriotic or a bad thing. Capri Cafaro, Jillian Turner, Molly Hemingway, great to see you this Sunday.